Good morning, Stonecrest. Good morning. I love that I have wonderful friends in this corner of the room this morning and in the front. Welcome to Stonecrest family. We're just so excited that we get to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords this morning. Amen. He is so good and he is so faithful and he is why we are here today. And so will you stand as we worship the King of Kings? So Jesus, we welcome you. Would you put out your hands just as a posture of worship with me this morning? Father, we adore you. God, we adore you. Lord, we pray this morning for a picture of heaven. Lord, we thank you that your banner over us is love. So we just say, will you say this with me? Come, Lord Jesus, come. Lord, come, Lord Jesus, come in the distraction, come in the noise. Come, Lord Jesus, come. As we learn, Lord, today that you are our bread of life. We love you, Lord, and give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I'll praise. I'll praise in the valley. I'll praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure. Praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when outnumbered. I'll praise when surrounded. Oh, 'cause praise is the water my enemy's drowning. Come on, as long. Oh, as long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul.
Yeah, I gotta.
Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, my soul. Yeah.
Come on, I'll praise.
Oh, I'll praise when I feel it, and praise when I don't.
Praise 'cause I know.
Yeah, I'll praise 'cause I know that you're still in control. Oh, 'cause praise is my weapon, yeah, it's more than a sound. Oh, my praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul,
I'm gonna praise.
Praise the Lord. Oh, my soul,
I won't.
'Cause I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I'm gonna praise the Lord, oh my soul. Yeah.
Come on. Here we go. Let's sing this out. I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign.
I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign. I'll praise 'cause you reign. I'll praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful. I'll praise 'cause you're true. I'll praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign. I'll praise 'cause you reign. I'll praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful. I'll praise 'cause you're true. I'll praise 'cause there's nobody greater.
Come on, I'll praise.
I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign. I'll praise 'cause you reign. I'll praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful. I'll praise 'cause you're true. I'll praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I'm gonna praise the Lord, oh my soul, yeah.
Say it again, he's sovereign.
I'll praise cause you're sovereign. I'll praise cause you reign. I'll praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise cause you're faithful. I'll praise cause you're true. I'll praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise cause you're sovereign, Lord. I'll praise cause you reign. I'll praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise cause you're faithful, and I'll praise cause you're true. I'll praise cause there's nobody great.
Come on, I'll praise.
I'll praise cause you're sovereign. I'll praise cause you reign. I'll praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise cause you're faithful, and I'll praise cause you're true. I'll praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I'm praising the Lord. Oh, my soul, oh, praise the Lord, oh, my soul.
I won't,
no, I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I'm gonna praise, oh, Lord, oh, my soul.
Yes. He's worthy today, amen. Sing it out, you.
Oh, you, Lord, you are worthy. And no worship you for me, yeah, for all the things you've done for me. Oh, no one can worship you for me.
Here's my worship.
Oh, here is my worship. All of my worship, receive my worship. All of my worship,
Lord.
Oh, you, Lord, you are worthy. And no one can worship you for me. No one can worship you for me.
Things you've done.
Oh, for all the things you've done for me.
No one, yeah.
No one can worship you for me.
Here is my worship.
Here is my worship. My worship, all of my worship, receive my worship, yeah, all of my worship.
Here is my,
oh, here is my worship
to you alone,
all of my worship, receive my worship.
Sing this together. I will not.
And I will not be silent. I will always worship you.
As long
as
long as I am breathing, I will always worship you. Oh, and I will not be silent, I will.
There will be a prayer.
Every prayer we prayed in desperation
with songs of faith.
We sang to doubt and fear. And in the end, to see that it was worth it, He returns to wipe away our tears.
Come on, let's sing this out, church. Holy is the Lord. Yeah, He's worthy, God. Kings and Lord of Lords, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Amen. Blessed be the Lord. Blessed be the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Friends, this is your time to worship. This is your time to praise. This is not your name, just your neighbor's time to praise. This is a song, an anthem of praise that the saints are singing in right now. We get to join in the heavenly chorus, amen? We rock, get to rock heaven with our praise, amen? Why? Because he's worthy. He's worthy at 9:21 a.m. Amen? Can we sing that verse 3? I just feel like that's our... just a powerful for us to sing that. And on that day, we will join the resurrection and stand before the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, 1,000 generations will sing what? Worthy is the Lamb who was what? Slain. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day, we join the resurrection and stand. Beside the heroes of the faith, with one voice, 1,000 generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forever, forever he shall reign. So let heaven, with angels and the saints, we raise.
Faithful. I just
sing it out again for everyone.
I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, I'm gonna praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, yeah, I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I'm gonna praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, and how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. It's all we'll see, how great is our God. Oh, he's great.
Come on, how great.
And how great, oh, is our God. Oh, sing with me, how great is our God. And all we'll see how great, oh, how great is our God.
Yeah, oh, name above.
Oh, he's the name above all names.
You are
worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing how great, oh, is our God. Oh, he's the name above all names. He's the name above all names.
Oh, you are
worthy of all praise.
My heart
will sing how great. He's the name above all names.
Hey, you are
worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing how great is our God.
How great.
And how great is our God. Sing with me how great is our God.
All will see
how great is our God.
Oh, one more time, can we sing it out together? How great is he,
and how great is our God.
Isn't he
how great is our God? Oh, we'll see how great is our God.
How great is our God? How great is our God? Would you close your eyes with me just to think about that for a second? How great is our God? The God who formed the seas, the God who made this earth, the God who formed your body, lives in you. How great is our God? The God who carved the mountains, who painted the skies with stars, put the sun in place, the moon in place, is our God. And he calls us friend. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. It says in John 15, it says, verse 12, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, For the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you would go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, so that you will love one another. As I close this time, would you put out your hands just to receive that blessing? Father, we thank you that we are your friends. He doesn't call you servants. What does he call you? Friend. I just bless you, just even with myself, to be still this morning, to hear the still small voice of your Father saying, well done, good and faithful servant. Friend. So thank you, Lord, that you are a good, good friend. We say thank you. Can we just say thank you together? Thank you. So as a part of our worship, we believe that giving is part of worship. It's a sacrifice of praise. So we want to thank those who have given and want to say thank you. But if you have not given, there are three ways you can give: online, check, or text message. Those ways are on the screen, or you can go online. We also have boxes in the lobby. But I want to just thank the Lord for what he's done and given. So will you thank the Lord with me? Father, thank you for what you've given, what you've done. Lord, thank you for every penny, dime that was given. Lord, those like the widows, Mike, who gave all they have, Lord, we thank you for them. And Lord, may you take these giving and these offerings and this sacrifice of praise, Lord, and may you amplify it, Lord, to fund mission, to fund the work of ministry, Lord, to bless your people, to reach the nations. Lord, use every dime, nickel, penny, dollar, sign, everything for your glory. And Lord, for those who have given, bless them, Lord, and continue to meet every single need that they have. Lord, we love you and give you praise. And friends, can we say this together? And all God's people said, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I would love to just bless our kids to go down to program. Thank you so much, guys, for joining us in worship. You may be seated. For those who don't know me, my name is Siobhan Seaman. I'm the worship pastor here, and we're just so glad to be able to worship together. Amen. Amen. This month, we're so excited because Stonecrest is honoring Black History Month. If we could put that slide up on the screen. We're so excited because we're going to do that in different ways this season. We're going to do that with a gospel worship night that's taking place this Friday. So if you have nothing to do, come on down because it's going to be a great time. We could put that slide up. It's at 7 o'clock. I'm sorry, I'm blanking right now. My bad. It will come up soon. If it doesn't, it's on our website. But it's, I believe it's 7 o'clock. 7 o'clock, thank you. And then on March the 3rd, we have our family meal. And so after the second service, we are inviting you to bring a dish that represents your soul food in honor of Black History Month, and we're really excited about that. And last but not least, starting this Wednesday, we have our family conversations on what we believe. And so it's building a foundation of faith and just what God says in his word. And so we'll just take a few weeks to really delve into that. So without further ado, with any questions, just go on our website and see what we have going on. God bless you guys.
Good morning, Stonecrest. You survived more snow in this last week than we've had in the last, feels like, decade. It seems like as soon as we get uncovered from one, we're right back in into another one. And this is that time of the year, and if there's any kind of sliver of hope, is that Easter is early this year. We're going to be celebrating Easter the end of March. And so this is our first Sunday where we are stepping into historically what the church has celebrated as or remembered as Lent. And Lent actually goes back to the early church. It was a practice of the even in the apostolic age with the apostles and stuff, to celebrate Jesus' death and resurrection, to mark Easter aside as a holiday. And there was all this confusion of when should we celebrate, and the church was going on the Passover calendar, and every church was doing different. And then finally in 325 AD, there was a leadership, a council that came together of all of the church leaders and really wrestled through some deep theological issues of talking about the deity of Christ and the role of the Holy Spirit and the Trinity. And that Nicene Council really landed a lot of what we believe, a lot of what we even hold on to today and how we structure our faith. But one of the things that they did is they landed and said, this is when we as the church are going to celebrate Easter. And then they also said, the 40 days before Easter, let's set that aside as a Lent period, a period where we are preparing ourselves in a season of examination, in a season of reflection, and a season of anticipation for the power of the resurrection, Jesus' death and resurrection. And so as the church calendar has done that, we're stepping into that too. I think it's only fitting, coming out of a 40 days of prayer, that we continue this posture, that we continue a posture where we are reflecting, where we are praying, where we are giving ourselves and making the space and leaning in together so that Jesus can do a deeper work in us. Because we know that as he does a deeper work in us, he also does a work through us. And part of the 40 days, why 40 days? Because it was Jesus that went out into the wilderness where he was fasting and even went through a season of temptation and a deepening of his commitment and his devotion and his connection with the Father that prepared him for the ministry that he was going to set in front of him, that was set in front of him. And so just as Jesus took that time, separated himself to connect with the heart of the Father, that's what this Lent season is. And so there are three rhythms or three postures that we're taking and placing ourselves in over this. And the first one is creating space. Creating space. Traditionally, there has been a fast that has gone along with Lent. And that's what the invitation is. And I'll unpack that a little bit more today as we go. But we fill our lives with so much stuff. And I'm going to talk about that a lot today. And Lent is a season where we can say, like, no, I'm going to fast from things that fill me up. Why? So that it can create space for the more. And so we create room and we crave for more. We feast. We feast on the goodness and the love of God. And so that as we create this space, it creates a hunger for more. It creates a hunger for more of God. And we center on the cross. We start looking forward to Good Friday, the place of lament and reflection, as we reflect on the sins and the agony and the pain that we placed on Jesus, and anticipation for the resurrection. And so this season, as we step into Lent, our series is Encountering Jesus, to center in on the cross and his work. And we're going to be exploring together the seven I am statements of Jesus. Throughout the book of John, there are seven different times where Jesus is teaching, or Jesus is performing a miracle, or Jesus is confronting them. And he starts a statement and he says, I am. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the true vine. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then Easter Sunday, we will come together and we will unpack his I am statement, his declaration that says, I am the resurrection and life. These are powerful statements of Jesus saying, the world may define me this way. You may even define me this way. You may try to conform me into this image of what you want me to be. But I'm telling you, this is who I am. It's his declaration. It's Jesus in his own words saying, this is who I am. And the words that he uses, I am, is significant because it goes back. It goes back to the time of Moses, where Moses encounters God at the burning bush. And as we've unpacked before, you know, Moses struggling with his identity of who he was, not exactly sure. And God showed up and goes, I see you and I've chosen you. I chose you for you to be the spokesperson, for me to use you to set my people free. And Moses goes, well, I'm so unqualified. I can't do this. And God tells Moses, he says, but I've chosen you. You're going in my name. And then Moses, probably looking for an out, says, well, then tell me, what am I supposed to say to Pharaoh? Who are you? And God's response was, I am who I am. See, that speaks of his eternal nature. And that God is all sufficient. He was in the beginning. He is now. And he will be. He is. I am. That he exists in and of himself. That he is absolute all. That there's no other way to describe him. And then when Jesus came, he uses the same name that Yahweh used, declaring that I am. I was, I will be, but I am now. And it encompasses yesterday, today, and forever. So today, this powerful declaration that we step into is in John chapter 6, where Jesus declares and says that I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Jesus is here declaring that I am the one. I am the one that will bring real sustenance and satisfaction and fulfillment to your life. You see, we all want our life to be significant. We search for meaning and fulfillment, and we pursue things that will lead us to that good life where we're satisfied, where we're content. And so what do? We pursue things. We pursue people, accomplishments, activities, experiences, all to fill us up. We think that if we are full, that if we are full with all of the good things that we could pursue, that we can hold on to, that we will be happy, satisfied, and fulfilled. But my friends, being full of good stuff, and being satisfied are not the same thing. Last week, it was my day off and Lisa's day off, and we were enjoying a Sabbath, and we had to run some errands, and we came to the grocery store, and we were looking and like, what do we want for dinner? And a couple weeks ago we went out, and I kind of went out on a limb. You know, you go to a restaurant, you kind of always get the same thing kind of there, where I went out, I'm like, you know what, I'm going to try something new. I normally don't get pork chops, but for some reason pork chop just jumped out on the menu. I'm like, I'm going to get that. And I ate it, and it was really good. And so we were going through the store, and I told Lisa, I'm like, you know what, let's give pork chops a shot tonight. You know, it's not on our normal menu. You know, normally it's like a pork tenderloin or a steak or a chicken, but let's give it a shot. And I have a sous vide, which is a way of cooking, so I looked it up and tried it, seasoned it, and it was good. And I remember eating the meal that night, and we had some good salad and baked potato, and just really enjoyed it. And I remember cutting it and eating, and I was full, and I was satisfied. And then later this week, it got really busy. Different activities and things were things were going on at the church, and got home late one night and grabbed a little snack before, and I'm like, I'm getting ready for it. I'm like hungry, like there was like I need something. So I go to the refrigerator and I look, and we had a leftover pork chop, and I'm like, okay, that's good. And so I took the pork chop out, I put it in the microwave, I sat down and I ate it, and at the end I was like, yeah, that kind of filled me up. But I wasn't satisfied. It was really good the first time, but reheating it the second time, it wasn't the same. You see, I think so many times we're tempted and we're tricked into believing that in order to be satisfied, to find that deep satisfaction, that we have to be full, that we have to fill ourselves. We have to fill ourselves with all of these things in life. But being filled with all of the things that we try to fill ourselves with doesn't mean that we will be satisfied. Someone asked J.D. Rockefeller, who was at that time the richest man in the world and probably one of the still the richest men that lived. And someone asked him and says, how much money, Mr. Rockefeller, will be enough? Will be enough for you? And his response, legend has it, and says, just a little bit more. Just a little bit more. You see, being full does not guarantee that there's going to be satisfaction. So as we, in this Lent season, and even in this message and in this week, start asking yourselves, as you reflect and you examine and you look at your life, where are the places that you are going after just a little bit more? Where is the little bit more showing up in your life? What is it that you think? And maybe it may not be obvious. This may be one of those where you got to sit down this afternoon and really think about it. But what are those things that you look that, hey, I'm going after this so that I will be satisfied? You see, our tendency, especially in our culture here, is that we keep filling ourselves up. We fill ourselves up with stuff. Man, how many times, just notice, just drive around and look and count how many Amazon delivery trucks that you see. How many UPS? Because every time you do that, you know that there's someone that's sitting on their couch a couple days before and says, oh, I want that. Boom. I want that. I want that. But before, it had to be, you had to go to the store, old school, pick out something and come. And now it'll get delivered to you. You even get clothes now where you can have it. And I'm like, oh, I'll try everything on. And if I don't like it, I'll just send it right back. You don't even have to go to a fitting room. So all of this stuff and activity, the activities that we do and our experiences, vacations, trips, parents, right? Sporting events, all of these activities, relationships, achievements, success. And we keep filling ourselves up. We keep taking on more and more and more until we either drop over out of pure exhaustion. Because if we keep going after the stuff, possessions, activities, experiences, relationships, success, achievements, we are going to tire ourselves out because it is exhausting. And I think that's one of the reasons why we look around in our society that people are so tired. Either that, or we're going to find ourselves on an episode of Hoarders or a remake of WALL-E. Remember that movie, Disney movie? Where it showed the future, like 200 years, where we don't even have to walk. We just float around, and we got a little digital thing on our thing, and we can just put whatever we want to eat, whatever we want, and it just shows up in our little pod. And it's just consuming. even the good things that we go after. I think we're smart enough to know, like, hey, if I'm going after this to fill myself and it's destructive, I may be addicted to it and not entrapped in it, but I know that it's not good. The problem that most of us say is that we fill ourselves up with good things. And the good things that we go after so often can cover up or hide or suppress those hunger pains of wanting the deeper things, of looking for that true satisfaction and the contentment in life. C.S. Lewis, an author, said this. He goes, I sometimes wonder whether all the pleasures are not substitutes for joy, that we look at the stuff. My friends, what I want to say today, what Jesus says in John chapter 6, verse 35, where he says that I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. What Jesus is saying here is he's declaring that satisfaction can only be found in me. That Jesus is in effect telling us that I don't want you to spend your life running after and chasing fullness and satisfaction, meaning, purpose, the deeper things in life. I want to offer you that. I want to offer satisfaction. I want to offer contentment. I want to offer peace and joy and love, regardless, no matter what circumstances that you are going through, no matter what changes in your life, that I want to give this to you. I am the bread of life. Hope, joy, peace, love. It's yours in me. And so we jump to John chapter 6, verse 35. But let me set the stage in the context of what took place here leading up to Jesus making this powerful declaration that I am the bread of life. And see, where we pick this up in John chapter 6, even though it's early in the book of John, if you look at this in a harmony study of all of the different gospels, this actually takes place in the latter half of Jesus' ministry. This is year 2 of 3. So in just several months from now, Jesus will begin his journey back to Jerusalem, where he will prepare for his death and resurrection. And see, up to this point, Jesus is hitting the high point of his ministry. His teachings, his healings, his miracles, him challenging the power establishments of the day and the Roman Empire and the religious leaders is creating quite a following. And there's something stirring, and they're recognizing that Jesus is an answer to some of the questions and the things in life that they're longing for. And so they follow him. Crowds. And we pick up this story in John chapter 6, and there's a large crowd that's coming, and he's teaching, and it's recorded that there's 5,000 men there, plus women and children. And so this is a large crowd, and it's getting late at night, and Jesus sees their need. He sees their longing. He sees their need for sustenance. And so he asks his disciples, what are we going to do? And he already knew what he was going to do, and he brings them along. And they come back and they say, and many of you who grew up in church and Sunday school know this story, and there was a little boy, he had 2 fish and 5 loaves, and they take it, he gives them up, Jesus prays and blesses, has everyone sit down, and he performs an incredible miracle where he feeds everyone there, and not just feeds them, but feeds them until they are full and satisfied, and there are baskets left over. It was a powerful miracle. It's one of the only miracles that are recorded in all 4 of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But because they ate, because the crowd sees that Jesus is the answer to so many of their needs, they start conspiring and they say, we look around and there's no good candidates out there that can deliver freedom and peace and prosperity and the things that we're looking for. Jesus is the only one. It's not the high priest or the religious leaders, and it's not Caesar in Rome. It's got to be Jesus. And so they start to try to convince Jesus to force him to become their king. And so it says here that Jesus escaped quickly because the crowd wanted to conform Jesus into their image, what they needed. But Jesus didn't come. He didn't come to make their life better. He came to give them a new life. It's a big difference. And so we must always ask ourselves the same question. Are we trying to conform Jesus into our image, our needs, our wants, or are we following who Jesus is? That's why digging into these statements where Jesus in his own words says, I am the bread of life. And so Jesus slips away and then performs another incredible ministry as the disciples, the 12, went ahead to the other side of the lake. Jesus hung around, walked on water. He met them on the other side. And as they were coming on to the other side of the lake, they ran into Jesus again. And they started questioning him. And so in verse 25, we pick up the story again. And they found Jesus on the other side of the lake. And they asked him, Rabbi, teacher, when did you get here? We missed you. And then Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. You want to be with me because I fed you. Not because you understood the miraculous signs. But don't be so concerned about perishable things like food. Spend your energy instead seeking the eternal life that the Son of Man came to give you. For God the Father has given him, me, the seal of approval. And see, what Jesus is doing here is he's beginning to expose their heart. What they really want, they want food and miracles. They're saying to him, feed me, because if you feed me, then I'm going to be satisfied. But Jesus keeps inviting them to the more. He has been teaching for almost 2 years about the Father's heart and the new life that he is ushering in. But they keep pushing him. They keep trying to corner him. They keep the pressure on him. Verse 28, they replied, we want to perform God's work too. What should we do? We want this power. We want it that we could feed ourselves. Yes, what should we do? But Jesus told them. I love how he does. How he just takes their expectations and brings it back to his reality. Not their reality, but his reality. This is the only work that God wants from you. This is the only work that God wants from us, is to believe in the one he has sent. Who did he send? He sent Jesus. And you think here, Jesus, being Jesus and his teacher, that'd be enough. Like, okay, Jesus, I get it. We believe and we will follow. No, they keep pushing. Why? Because their hunger. Their hunger to be full, to be filled, was so intense that they missed what Jesus was inviting them into. He says, show us again a miraculous sign if you want us to believe you. What can you do, Jesus? Okay. Not that feeding 5,000 isn't enough. Giving sight to a blind man, leading someone who is a cripple or a leper, raising the dead, walking on water. If that's not enough, what can you do for me now, Jesus? After all, now they're going to throw in the trump card of religion right here. After all, our ancestors ate manna while they were journeying through the wilderness. In fact, Jesus, don't you know what the Bible says? The Bible says Moses gave them bread from heaven to eat. And see, for those of you who don't know the story, what they're referring to there is that when God used Moses to bring his people out of slavery, They wandered in the desert for 40 years until he brought them into their new home. Every day, the Lord provided everything that they needed. He provided his presence for them, a visible sight of the presence of God, either by a cloud, by day when they could see it, or when the sun went down and they couldn't see the cloud, it was a pillar of fire. And they were always aware his presence is with us. But he also sustained them and gave them that everything that they needed. He provided for them this manna, a bread that came down from heaven to sustain them. And every day to remind them that God sees them and he cares for them and he wants to meet their need. And this is what they're calling Jesus to. They're asking him, Jesus, it says, fix me, provide for me. But what they're missing in their ask is his presence. And so next we see Jesus further again exposing and calling them out. And he says, you are following me. You are following me because of what you will benefit from me. Not because you want to be with me. And so Jesus calls them back. He calls them back to the more. And he corrects them. He says, you don't know the Bible as good as you think you do. I tell you the truth. Moses didn't give you the bread from heaven. My Father did. And now he offers you true bread from heaven. The true bread of God is the one who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. He gives life to the world. It's Jesus. And sir, they said, they won't give up. They won't give up because their hunger for the more is so strong. Give us that bread every day. Feed us. Do the miracles. But Jesus replied, and here's his statement that we started with. He says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. And whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But you haven't believed me, even though you have seen me. And so Jesus declares that I'm the source. I'm the source of sustenance and satisfaction, and you will find me. But I'm not just giving you that. I'm giving you my presence. My friends, you can fill yourself with everything else, even good things. Good things will never satisfy. Every time you go after the things, your life will be left with wanting more. This crowd, like us too, we want food and miracles to make our life better. But what Jesus is saying here is your perceived need is not your actual need. And Jesus is saying, believe in me, trust me, that I'm the one that will bring you life, not stuff. One of the TV shows that I like, I can't even remember the name, but it's one of those shows where a group of people, three people, they travel the world, and they go to all these resort places, and they travel, and they try the food and fancy and all of the stuff, and you're watching that. And sure enough, somewhere throughout the whole episode, as they're on a yacht or getting prepared to go on a hike up the mountains, or they're just sitting in a mansion, at some point, one of the characters goes, this is life. But you know what? How many of us want that life? But that life will always come to an end because the show will end and you got to leave and go home from vacation. We want that life, though. When you read through the New Testament, especially in the book of John, there are two different Greek words that are most often used for life. See, for us, life is just one English word. But in Greek, there were two. The two words for life is, the first one is bios. And here, this refers to life. This refers to the physical life, our physical body, nature, the tangible physical system that we live in and the things that we have all in and around the world. This is where we get our English word biology from. That bio, it's our physical, tangible life and the things that are around us. But the second word is Zoe. And Zoe refers to something much deeper. It can take into account the bio, but it goes beyond that into an uncreated, divine life. That, as the New Testament writers often use it in context, is uniquely possessed by God, tied in with eternal life. The Greek word itself is a quality and significance of existence. It is the essence of living, and sometimes the ultimate goal or purpose of life. Bio, the physical life that we can hold on to. Zoe, the life of satisfaction, of meaning, of purpose. And what Jesus is saying here is he said that I am the bread of Zoe. Life. Life with purpose, divine, eternal, significant, and existence. But see, here's what the crowd did. They came to Jesus. They wanting an answer to their bio life. They were looking for solutions for a Zoe need, but wanting a bio answer. Friends, our perceived need is not our actual need. What they needed was joy, hope, peace, love. But what they wanted to settle for was the stuff, the bio. We cannot fix our Zoe life problem by filling ourselves with bio solutions. Bio solutions, while they're good, they fill us temporarily. But they always leave us hungry for more because bio solutions are always rooted in the temporary. Your real need for satisfaction in life is Zoe. Looking for the ultimate goal, purpose, and satisfaction. And so we need a Zoe solution for a Zoe problem. And we have to resist. Resist the hunger pains for bio solutions when what the hunger is calling for is a Zoe need. Bio solutions are not bad, but they'll never satisfy us. But we still go after them. Why? Because we can control bio solutions, or we think we can. That's where the trick is. So we try to control our health. We try to control our job, our relationships, our activities, our success, vacations, experiences, stability, finances, all of which are good. And they are blessings to us. When we get a good job, when we get a raise, when we get a bonus, when we have a great vacation, when we have stellar experiences, where we experience success, those are blessings. And oftentimes, those are blessings that God gives us. But here's what we do, is we pursue the blessing, and we miss the one who gives the blessing. It's just like the manna. Every day, it was God, the Father, lovingly providing everything that they needed. But sometime over the thing, they lost that God was the fun. He's the loving Father that was giving. And they wanted the stuff. And so, my friends, in this Lent season, as we step into this, in a season of reflection and examination, what are the bio solutions that you're pursuing for satisfaction, fulfillment, and purpose and joy in your life? What are the Savior substitutes that you are craving, that you are pursuing, that you're filling your life with instead of the Savior, the bread of life? Because the Savior substitutes will never satisfy. There is no Zoe life outside of Jesus. Jesus is the one that offers life when he came close and lived with us. He wraps up this sermon and this message in verse 47. He says, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes has eternal life, Zoe life. Yes, I am the bread of life. Zoe, your ancestors ate manna in the wilderness and they all died. Bio life. Anyone who eats bread from heaven, however, will never die. That's Zoe. I am the living, the Zoe bread who came down from heaven, and anyone who eats this bread will Zoe live forever. And his bread, and this bread which I offer you is so that you may Zoe live. This is my flesh. And Jesus said, you'll never find. He said, this stuff in the world that you find, it will never fill you. Turn away from that and turn to me. And then do you see what happened as you read the story here? Is that those in the crowd, they finally got it. They finally understood. And they said that Jesus isn't going to meet just their bio needs of what he wants, but he's giving them access to meet their Zoe needs. But to meet their Zoe needs means that they have to put to death their bio deeds, to stop craving, to stop going after. They knew what Jesus was saying, that if you want Zoe life, it means that you have to put to death the things of this life. And trust me, just like your forefathers did, that I will provide both for you in bio life, but also give you my presence, which is Zoe life. And at that point, many of the disciples turned away and deserted him. Remember the crowds. We want you as king. And now they leave him. And then Jesus turns to the 12 and asks them, says, are you going to leave too? And then Simon Peter, he declared this. And this is the prayer that all of us in this Lent season, that we come back to and we put a stake in the ground and we say the same. Lord, to whom would we go? For you have the words that give Zoe eternal life. And we believe and we know that you are the Holy One of God. You have the words of Zoe. We believe and we follow. Let these be our words for Lent. So as we close today, I come back to the three things that we say that we're going to lean into in this Lent season. And the first is create space to fast. Saying no to good things, the bio things in life, so that you can say yes to the best, to the Zoe things, the things that deeply satisfy you. You see, by saying no and fasting, it reorders our desires and redirects our appetites. Fasting will detach ourselves from the good, from the bio, so that we can receive the good, the Zoe, from the Lord. At our Ash Wednesday service, which was a fantastic time, I was talking with someone afterwards, and one of our teens came in and knows me well, and says, oh, so Pastor Doug, what are you going to fast of over Lent? Are you going to fast from vegetables? And I'm like, I like the way you think. Yes, I am. I'm going to fast from vegetables, exercise, and watching football over Lent. That misses the point. We fast from something that we love. We fast from something that we crave. We fast from something that we look for that will give us some sort of joy and satisfaction, that will give us life. And we say no to that to remind us that where our life is not found in bio life, it is not found in drinking a good cup of coffee. It's not found in the food that we eat. It's not found in what we watch. It's not found in our social media or phones, our connections. It's not found in these things. And so ask the Lord, what is it that He wants you to give up? A pleasure, so that it will remind us that our true life and satisfaction comes from Jesus, who says that I am the bread of life. When our kids were small and we started practicing Lent in our house, we all kind of shared and says, here's what I want to give up. And one of our kids would go to bed every night and wanted a stuffed animal, and this gave them pleasure and safety and comfort, and couldn't fall asleep if they did not have their stuffed animal. And when we shared why we do Lent and what it means of giving something up good so that it reminds us that God will meet us in those places, one of our children says, okay, I'm going to give up. I'm going to give up my stuffed animal for Lent. My friends, that's the invitation. It creates the space in that there for my child, for God to show up and say, you can sleep and you can do it because I will be present. And so the invitation for all of us is, what will we say no to create the space for the Zoe life, for God to show up? And not only do we create space by fasting, we also feast, because when we feast, it craves more. It reminds us that God is with us. And so not only do we say no to that, but we start going. And can I encourage you in this season to start a gratitude journal? A gratitude journal, because the cravings are going to be strong for what you give up. Every day you're going to be like, I want that cup of coffee. I want to go online. I want to watch TV. I want my stuffed animal. And if you're not there looking and saying, where is Zoe? Where's the bread of life showing up in my life? This will be unbearable. But when you start looking around and seeing the places where God, His presence, fire by night or cloud by day, shows up, you start feasting and gratifying more. And now you see what happens. Our attitudes and our alignment shift from bio to Zoe. And then we center on the cross. We give up so God can give to us, and we can also give to others. In Isaiah, when they were going through a fast, Isaiah called them back and it says, you're missing the point of fasting. The fasting you're doing is just trying to gain credit with God, for him to overlook and for you to feel better about yourselves and for all of this stuff. But all this going on, look at all the people that are suffering, that you're oppressing, that are oppressed around you. The fast that I want is not this. You can read it in Isaiah 58. What I want is you to fast, but to do something about this. Give your life to others. And so as we step into Lent, we center on the cross by giving to others, creating space, celebrating, and craving the more. That gratitude journal, rooting in the Word. Remember what Jesus said when he was tempted to jump into bio life? What was his response? It was, no, I'm staying true to Zoe life. That man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. So I invite you this Lent season to fast, to dig into his word, to crave the more, and to give to others. Because Jesus declared that I am the bread of life.
Amen. Amen. It's so good to be reminded of that truth, that I've heard that Jesus, how he declares that he is the bread of life, probably throughout my whole life, but to be reminded that it's not about filling the need through other means, that need for abundant life with other things. It's about getting that need met through him. It reminds me of a movie called My Big Fat Greek Wedding. And in that movie, it's a funny scene, actually. It's quite comical. And the father used Windex for everything. Like, if you have a wart, you squirt it with Windex. If you have a rash, spray it with Windex. He constantly uses this funny little thing with the Windex, and it's just so comical. But friends, I believe that's really true life for us. There are things we use Windex, the things of food and TV or fill in the blank, money, success. We use it to meet a need, like the Windex to a rash. Like, that just doesn't work. And the Lord wants to satisfy our needs for more of him. And I just want to bless you to really latch onto this, because this could change your life. No, it does change your life. To get your needs met by the one who can really do it, both the physical and the spiritual needs. Will you stand as we close this service? I do want to remind you this as well, that please take time, whether you're practicing Lent or not, we can all latch onto Jesus for our needs. So please ask yourself this week, I charge this with you, where are the things that you do in your life to meet spiritual needs that the Lord wants to be meeting himself? So I just bless you. If you would put out your hand, I'd just love to bless you with this. Psalm 63. I bless you to look on the sanctuary and behold the glory of the Lord, because his steadfast love is better than life. I bless you that your lips would praise the Lord. So as you bless the Lord and as you live, that the Lord's name would be on your lips, and that you would raise your hands to this. I bless you that the Lord would satisfy your soul as if with the richest of fat and foods, and that your mouth would praise the Lord with joyful lips. Lord, we just thank you for what you're doing in our lives and this reminder of truth, Lord, and show us the places that we try to get our deepest needs met with other things other than you. Please show us those places, Lord. We love you and we give you praise for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Guys, God bless you. Have a great day. Please take time to greet each other and to love each other today. Take care. Bye-bye.
just stand kind of in line with me there. It's fine.